Good morning. My name is Akash Singh and today I'm going to explain the chapter Land as a Natural Resource or Natural Resources Land. So, as we all know that millions of years ago there was no life on Earth. It was a ball of fire, then it cooled down, and after that the Earth got divided into four different spheres. Or into four different parts. Those were the lithosphere, the hydrosphere, the atmosphere, and the biosphere. The lithosphere meant the land. The land on which we walk upon was the lithosphere. Hydrosphere consisted of all the water bodies of the earth. The atmosphere was all the air around us. The biosphere was all the living or biotic organisms of the earth. Now, at first, there was no life on earth except for microorganisms. So plants were the first organisms, the living organisms, to be generated by the earth. Okay. Well, after that we come to the composition of land and water in the earth. So land consists about 30% of the surface area of the earth, and water is composed of around 70% of earth is around water. So the most important natural resource upon which human activity is based is land. So land is used for various purposes. First of all, that comes as an agrarian country, the first thing that comes up to our mind is agriculture. Agriculture or growing crops was the primary use of land, primarily used land for that purpose. Second, it is used by animals for grazing. Nowadays it is used to build industries, for constructing roads, for building houses, for mining, all these things. But primarily it was used for agriculture. So land, these are all the uses of land. Animals depend on land for grazing. So land kind of fulfills their primary requirement of food also. So if somebody wants to build a house, he needs land. If somebody wants to set up an industry, which is a main source of employment and indirectly leads people and indirectly gives people a source of livelihood, you need land for that too. Any sort of business cannot survive without a land. Okay, you need land to set up a certain business, to set up a certain industry. In order to reach that place, you need roads, which is also made on land. For mining means taking out all the natural resources that are inside land, that are found inside Mother Earth or land. One example is coal, another example is iron. Again, to set up industries, you need iron, you need coal. All these raw materials will be given by land itself, will be extracted out from land itself through mining. Now, land has two components, basically the organic and inorganic components. Land is composed of basically these two components. So what do you mean by organic and what do you mean by inorganic? Organic means all the living or biotic factors which are dead now. The living things which when dead are decomposed by microorganisms and cause nitrogen fixation, which enriches the soil. It also adds humus. The dead animals and plants add humus to the soil, which increases the soil fertility. Okay, as you can see, dead and decomposed plant and animal matter, when plant and animal matter gets decomposed after their death, they provide humus to the top layer of the soil, which is extremely important for plants to grow on it. Next is the inorganic or non-living things, okay, which were never living, like rocks minerals, certain minerals, rocks, all these are inorganic components upon which are through which soil is produced, basically. So land is basically composed of soil, and when inorganic and organic components deteriorate through time, soil is produced then. So what is soil used for? Soil is used for mainly for agriculture and all these things. Okay, now the use of land depends on various factors. How we use a certain amount of land, a certain piece of land, depends on various factors. First is the quality of the soil. If the quality of the soil is fit for agriculture, only then we can do agriculture or practice agriculture in that soil, in that patch of land. If it is unsuitable for agriculture, if it is not suitable for agriculture, then we cannot do agriculture in that particular soil, in that particular land. Second is the climatic conditions. Again, climatic conditions. The climate of a mountain area will be different from that of a plain area. So therefore, in mountain areas, we have often seen that tea is planted. The agriculture of tree is done. Tea is done in mountainous areas, whereas in the plains you see mainly wheat, rice, all these things are grown, which is not usually grown in the mountainous areas. So climatic conditions are largely influence how a patch of land will be used or how a certain land will be used. Third is the technological requirement of a certain place. For example, in India, we are basically agrarians. So we basically depend on agriculture, and we export things like certain minerals like iron ore and certain other minerals like uranium. We export different types of masalas and everything. So we don't have that level of technological requirement. Well, whereas if you see a country like China, they are mainly based on technology. The main source of income comes from technology. So of course, if they get a patch of land, it's more likely that they will use it for technological development and not for agriculture like us. Both have their importance in their own places, but both of them are important. It depends on the technological requirement of the country, and it depends on the non-technological requirements of the country. So of course, if a patch of land is more likely to be used in China for technological requirements, for technological advancements, rather than in India. Next is the minerals found. The types of minerals found in a certain place also affect how that land will be used. For example, if a certain amount of land, say land X, has a certain amount of coal or petroleum inside it, then it will be used as a mining. Mining will be done there. Certain mining companies will buy that land and start doing mining there in order to extract that coal or iron or anything that is found here, that is found in that particular piece of land. They won't obviously use it for agriculture, right? So next is the density of population. The density of population is another important factor. If a densely populated area like, if I take the example of a densely populated area like Calcutta, where the population is extremely dense, a person won't buy a piece of land to practice agriculture, will he? Of course he won't. He will use that for other commercial purposes, like setting up a restaurant or setting up a small office or something like that, because it won't be financially viable for him to buy an area in a densely populated area. Also, the densely populated areas have a piece of land in a densely populated area is much more costly than that in a less densely populated area. Okay, so the study of this thing, how to use land according to your requirements, is known as land use pattern or land use patterning. This is an important point. You must mark it. You must learn it. Okay, this whole thing, how to use land of a certain place, the study of this entire thing is known as land use patterning. Okay. Now, do animals depend on soil too? Of course they depend on soil. They depend on soil for their basic needs, like food, clothing and shelter. Well, how? Well, animals, first of all, animals like herbivores, like cows and deers, all of these need land. All of these need to feed on land, on grass, which is grown on land, in order to survive. So that indirectly, soil is providing them food, as all the plants are grown from soil itself, grow in soil itself. So it is providing them food, first of all. Second, it provides shelter to many sorts of insects, many sorts of reptiles like snakes, mouse, many other animals like mouses, earthworms. All these animals live inside the soil. So of course, soil or land provides them shelter. So it actually fulfills their basic needs, directly or indirectly. You see, carnivores are also dependent on soil indirectly, as the sheep on which they prey on needs to feed on plants, and plants need soil to grow. So indirectly, the carnivores are also dependent on soil. Okay. Next is soil formation. What are the main factors which affect soil formation? So the main factors which there are five main factors which affect the formation of a soil. The first is the parent rock. So what is a parent rock? Soil is basically broken down or small bits of stones or rocks. When the stone or rock gets weathered and broken down into small granules, into smaller granules, then soil is formed. And it takes time. It takes time to break on. Okay. So first of all is the parent rock. For example, black soil is common in India. So black soil is derived from the lava rock. When the lava rock gets weathered and gets into small and gets converted to small granules, it becomes black soil. Next is the topography. As I said earlier, mountains, plateaus, all these things are not fit for agriculture of wheat, rice, all these things, because they have slopy lands. Of course, terrace farming can contribute to the terrace farming can change that thing. Through terrace farming we can cultivate certain other things in hilly areas, but generally they are not the ideal. The place of the mountain is not an ideal place for wheat and rice cultivation, whereas it is an ideal place for tea cultivation. So of course the topography will affect the soil formation, because if there is no cultivation, the soil won't get mined by the trees. And second of all, the topography, along with the topography, the climate is also important, as a certain person cannot grow wheat in a climate which is always rainfall inducive. Okay, so climate affects soil formation to a lot of extent. Okay, temperature, rainfall also affect soil formation. In areas where you get extremes of temperatures, like deserts, the rocks are easily weathered. In mountainous areas, as I was saying, there is more flow of water, so the rocks get easily weathered, because water cuts rocks. It works as a catalyst in weathering of rocks. Okay. So next is the vegetation of a certain place. The more the vegetation, the more cracked rocks will be formed, because the roots of certain plants, of actually all plants, break through rocks and helps accelerates the process of disintegration of rocks, thereby hastening the process of soil formation. And last but not the least is time. The process of soil formation needs a certain amount of time. Without time, you cannot do certain amount of activity. A certain amount of activity cannot be attained without time. If you, for example, I cannot say that I can convert a rock into soil within a span of 1 year or 1 day or 1 or 2 days like that. It takes years and years of time naturally for a rock to become soil. Of course, human interference can lessen the amount of time, but human interference is not always logical in nature. So here I come to an end of Natural Resources Land. Hope you liked the video. Thank you very much.